from last time's video of the CD-ROM fitting the CD-ROM into the Amiga. And the last time, just to recap, and if you haven't watched that video, it's in the link is in the description below. I had bought one of these. The issue I have with this is that it has no audio port, which, you know, obviously goes through here. Now this is basically the same thing, exactly the same. It's an adapter, but with one difference. I mean, that's the power, but it also has the audio. That second thing in the CD-ROM drives, I've never known what that is, but I know that this is the audio out from the CD. So I'm gonna have to create a little mixer for this. With this one, it's like all exposed. This is what happens when you cheap out on stuff. And actually, it wasn't my intention to cheap out on it. This was the only one that I had found at the time. So, you know, I had no choice. I thought this is the only thing that's available. But along with that, I also got... I treated myself to this. I thought, okay, I might as well, now that I'm messing around with the side of things. I mean, before I had... That is the IDE interface. I had this one before, which, you know, has all my stuff on it. It's like, this is being the hard drive. I decided, okay, let's get one of these, an SD card one. Now, with this, I believe it's faster, and also, you know, I can get SD cards much cheaper. And this is like an 8 GB, for the price of an 8 GB, I can get a 32 GB one. I'm gonna do a complete reinstall, and another advantage of this would be, when I was setting this up, I had set Classic Workbench on this, and I'd recorded a video of Classic Workbench, of me installing Classic Workbench, going through it all, you know, after installing 3.9, but I had unfortunately lost that footage. I still cannot to this day find where it is. So when I install this, of course you've seen the 3.9, you've seen the hard drive, you know, prepping and stuff and partitioning. I don't need to show you that anymore, but I can show you the Classic Workbench installation. And this time I will not lose the footage. So that is, you know, something that's coming up also. For now, I will continue using this one, you know, with the drive until stuff for this is sorted, until I get the card back. Okay, so here we are again, and I managed to find, you know, a better IDE cable for the drive, so I'll be using this black one. Okay, so the keyboard, lift that lip up, and open out. I've got suspicions about this keyboard. The caps lock does not light up as bright, and it's a little, it can be a little sluggish on certain points. Like when I press reset, it doesn't reset, and I press it a couple of times and then it resets. I have no idea why. And why the caps lock is so, you know, the caps lock is dim to the point of me having to do this just to see it. I'm gonna try something first. I don't wanna stress any ports. I don't want this to short. Obviously, I'm gonna put insulation there. Okay, this will be sticking out here. Okay, there's some leeway here. There's some space there, there's a gap there, which you can see, you know, it's perfect. And I got my teeny little screwdriver. And they're so sweet. I like small miniaturized things. Okay, so I got it in. Okay, so that's done and secure. Let's put these diddlies back in. Okay, so here is where I made my markings for the drive. On the innermost side of the markings is where I will cut. I can cut that off so, you know, the drive can actually dip in and have a place to sit comfortably and be secure. And I've also made markings on the, I don't know who's made these markings, somebody before me. But the markings I'm looking at are here. This one and this one, which is, you know, where the drive will actually be, you know. So the marking is only going to be as thick as this, the height of that. So I need to do some measuring here and make sure I get the right height on both sides and make sure that's square. I hate doing this kind of thing. I really do, because it's just, oh, I don't want to make it wonky. But it'll be fine. Okay, so I have marked this out. It's like it's like 9 millimeters up on each side, and of course, you know, they're not exactly straight, and this is just one little ridge that I need to cut out. And I'm gonna need to get a Dremel tool out. I hate that thing. Well, I like it because it gets the job done, but I hate it because I hate using it. It kind of scares me a bit. Okay, first things first, the floppy drive. And secondly, the dear Akka here, which I'm going to remove. I've been told that this is a Jerry, yeah? This is a Jerry Plus. I've been told now there's a Tom Plus. I had no idea about it when I got this. The Jerry Plus only accepts PS2, type USB devices, like PS2 compatible USB devices. Whereas the Tom supports all of them, apparently. So I never even saw the Tom or knew about it back then. I have a feeling that when I actually bought this Jerry Plus, the Tom wasn't even out yet. Stupid Tom. Freaking Jerry. Okay, so the floppy drive is out. And that screw is out, so I can just unhinge that. And take this out. And we're done. So first things first. Safety? Well, I should do, but my eyes first, or should not be able to make any videos. Okay, so it comes together, and yeah, so this is why I hate doing this kind of job, because I'm not good at it. And I don't have the right tools for it. Okay, so I'm back and I've washed my Amiga, given it a shower, and now it's soaking and getting dry. And while that's happening, what I'm gonna do is I'm going to solder the power connections of the, you know, the power connections, the floppy connector. What I'm gonna do is add an extra one. I'm gonna triple it, like break into this and add an extra long one, which is how I'm gonna power this drive. But first, oh, I needed that. That was my fix. Right. With these, you have to watch out for something. I've taken this from an ATX power supply, and this is from the Amiga itself. Okay, so if you notice here, and it's hard because it's black, it's hard to show you, but you will notice that this thing has one notch up here, so it only goes in one way. Now, the notch is on this side, and this is from the Amiga. You have the red on this side, and you line this up, you know, they're both the right way up. You line this up, the red is on this side. Now, if you take one of these connectors and steal it from an ATX power supply, like that, you will notice the red is on this side. They use the red Commodore or whoever, you know, manufactured these. They decided to use red for, I think it's a 12 volt line, because I think this is 12 volts, this is 5 volts, I'm not sure, I forget. But they use it for, you know, a different one. So I remember getting a hard drive, and of course using connectors like these for the hard drive to power the hard drive. What I did was I connected this, instead of connecting it to the gray as it should, I connected it to that. So you get an incorrect voltage going into the hard drive, and in fact these two are swapped. So what happens? One of the hot chips on the hard drive becomes really, really hot, and the entire thing doesn't work anymore. So that's the result. So you do want to freaking watch out for this. Just in case, don't be fooled. So let's begin with this. I'll get my drapers too out. And this may take a little while, so do go and make yourself a tea. Not my tea, don't you stare. Don't you stare. Don't you dare steal my tea. You can stare all you like. Because I appreciate you staring here at my channel. I know I'm talking weird, but this is kind of like, you know, goofy talk. When my brain starts misfiring when it's thinking of too many things at once. Right, so again, remember these two. No, soldering iron, do not fall asleep. Just when I start, you know, using here, you start snoozing. Double checking. It's the yellow I need to connect to the red. Yes, I know, head smash. But it is. The yellow of the ADX goes onto that red. Just double check everything. And just solder. There we have it. And then trim. Show that everything is sturdy, good, insulated. And exactly the same with the rest of the wires. So then it's trim this, not too much, just enough. And then let it cool slightly and then tape it up. And yep, everything is fine. Perfecto. Okay, so now that we've done the power for the CD drive, we now sort out the audio. Now this is a bit of recycled from an old case, so just ignore all that it says. In fact, here we go. Doesn't have to bother us anymore. We can easily just plug that in here, like this. And that is the audio cable. Now this one, this small white one, I was puzzled on what that is. So that is a sound blaster, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong. You have left, right, left, ground, right. And here the colors of the wires are gonna be red, what is that color? It's unspeakable. Okay, so it's red, white, green, and black. So the white and the green in this case are gonna be ground. I'm glad that when I was doing my Amiga stereo separation project that I got a spare one of these. If you want to view the project, the link is in the description below, or in the Amiga playlist, or in the Electronica playlist. So, yeah, let's strip this wire. I hate stripping these with multi-core wires, because, you know, you have a fear of... Okay, so let's just move this out of the way, and we will tin this. So red and black, left and right, and green and white are ground. So green and white we join together, and so ground, because we're going to be joining another wire on that soon, and red we tin it, like this, and we get this here, and we start working on this. Basically what I'm doing now is making a very simple audio mixer between the Amiga's audio and the CD audio. Okay. All it is connecting the Amiga's audio parallel to the CD audio, however giving the CD audio a volume control. So, you know, you can control it, because I know that the CD audio is pretty loud in comparison. What am I doing? I need to snip this out. Okay. Now the other side. So it's stereo. Okay, so. Let's take these. Now we connect the CD's audio. Remember, this is left, this is right, and these two are ground. So these two, we're not interested in what these two are doing. Let's snip this, let's trim it, and let's so sound is going in here. And we do the same with the red one. Okay, there we go. So that is done. Let's just insulate that best we can. There we go. And the wiper is gonna be connected to the Amiga's audio output, that is. Right, so that is ground soldered. Now let's just tape it on here. And at the same time, insulating it. There we go, in there. Join you under this. You can be a new friend. Right, so what I've done is I have soldered, you know, the input. This is coming from the CD-ROM drive. So audio going into here, into the variable resistor on one side of it, and the wiper of the variable resistor, both is a stereo or dual gang variable resistor. Each of the wires is going to connect to, you know, Amiga left and right, and the ground from the CD drive, the ground audio, is going to connect obviously to the ground of the Amiga audio out. So yeah, that's the mixer sorted. And yes, my Amiga will have a volume control in the back for the CD. This will be coming out from the back of the Amiga next to the CD-ROM drive itself, and these three connect to the Amiga output, and that's it. Everything should be fine. Right, so here is the Amiga case, and wow, I've never known my Amiga to look this clean before. It's just like nice. So let's put the motherboard back in. So this is the top of the case, nice and clean, and this is where the CD-ROM drive will go, and this is where the volume control will fit. So all I need to do is just this like that, and then put that nut over it. Where the freak is that nut gone? So that is secure. It's got a nice volume control here. So what I've basically done is I've put some cardboard on to make it a bit more stable. And also, you know, it'll absorb any vibrations, because this kind of comes a little close to my Akka and I don't like that. Okay, so this is the floppy drive power and also the CD-ROM power. So we put that in here, and let's connect this floppy drive also, so we can, you know, gauge what we're doing. Okay, so the Amiga's audio. I want to make the soldering as clean as I possibly can and as far away from the board as I possibly can. Okay, with regards to audio ground can just be, you know, this shielding here. So just to save messing around with the circuit board, I'm gonna connect it to the shielding. Just makes things safer. And the least messing around with the circuit itself, the better. So that is audio ground sorted. Great. Each of these sides, this one and this one, is left and right. So I'm going to tin one of those sides. I'm not even going to touch the circuit board. I'm just going to do it from the RC sockets themselves. Okay. So left.
careful with the keyboard socket. I'm gonna melt that because we're in trouble. And dry.
There we go. So we have that done and it's clean. There's no messing around with the board, just directly on the RCA sockets. And that's all for that part of the circuit. I should have braided it, to be honest, but never mind. I'm sorry, those of you who don't approve of how I'm doing it, but I'm not an expert like you. Because I'm sure somebody somewhere will start going, what you doing? I sounded like Dracula then. What you doing? Oh, hold on a second. I need leeway for audio cable. Didn't think about that, did I? That's basically how it'll fit in. Let's make sure everything is connected well. Everything is right. And it'd be a wise idea to put the keyboard in. Someone pointed out to me the last time when I was installing my memory that it was on top of this lip. Yes, initially it was. I had taken it out and put it underneath, and that's the part I did not show. Make sure your accelerator board is underneath this thing. Mine wasn't when it was in shot, but I did take it out and put it underneath. Many people have strongly suggested to me, tower it, as in tower your Amiga, as in put it in a tower. No, I freaking don't want to. I refuse to do that because I want it in the form of an Amiga. And I will do whatever it takes. And this is one of the ways, one of the things I will do, you know, whatever it takes. So let's connect the keyboard in here. How did I do this last time with less experience than now? And how did I do it over there when it's harder to do? Okay, so crunch time. And I really hope this works. Okay, so that works. Let's check out CD audio. Which CD has audio? So we got some sound. And the volume control works. Okay, it's looking good. The cool thing about this is that it has opened up and... Ooh, look! Two eyes, nose, and a smiley face. He's eating my lens. Anyway, what I was saying is... the good thing about this is that it's opened the gateway, so I can use my old Amiga cover discs now, like I always used to. Okay, so I just have one more thing left to do. And it's kind of a request from a commenter to check sysinfo for my drives. Because when I was installing the Allegro CDFS, something was displayed about the speed. So, and hold on. So let's go to drives here. And DH0, which is the comeback flash, and speed. Okay, so here it is, 2.2 meg, which is, 2.3 meg, which is the same as his, or the same as everyone's, I guess. So let's see if we can speed that up with that. and the EID prefs. Okay, here, now I know what he's talking about. It says max PIO5, and the same with the CD drive, but it's only set to PIO0. Okay, you cannot actually change it then. No, you cannot change them at all. Oh, this thing came up again. Your drives could work much faster. You need fast ADA MK4 CFS ADA controller. Okay. What is one of those? If any of you know what the freak that is, could you let me know? Because, you know, I'd like to know. Anyway, I'll call it a day for now because this is a long video anyway. So, thank you so much for watching, for your likes and your shares, and of course do leave your thoughts in the comments below, and of course do subscribe for more. For now, I say adios.